Hello, I'm your host, Peter Komendowski, and welcome to Surviving Bad, where we explore Iowa stories of survival, hope, and inspiration. Today, a young man, Daniel Rosga, chronicles his journey of grief, healing, and in a powerful way, the wisdom he's gained in the 10 years since his brother passed tragically as a victim of an overdose of synthetic marijuana. His parents have championed the efforts of legislation and prevention to help spare other families a similar fate. And Daniel has grown up from boyhood to manhood at the center of grief, and this is his story. Daniel, thank you for joining us today. Can you give us a
little overview of,
I guess, life 10 years ago as a snapshot and where things are going and why you're here today?
Yeah, thanks so much for having me, Peter. Good to see you again. It's always been fun to cross paths over the last 10 years. 10 years ago, kind of crazy to think about, I would have just finished my freshman year of high school. My brother, who was 18 at the time, was a week past his graduation as a senior and passed away. He, like you've mentioned, he used a synthetic drug called K2. And so I was 15 and a half years old. And to be honest with you, it almost feels like a different lifetime ago. It's such a long time, just given the fact that I was in such a developmental period in general in my life. And then you throw something like losing a brother into that mix. It just, to be honest with you, my memory sometimes gets foggy, but I still very much remember, you know, these last 10 years. Finished high school, went to college around Chicago area, and got a major in biblical studies, actually. That's something that I wanted to do. I decided on shortly after my brother passed away, actually. His death kind of solidified that path for me that I've always kind of thought about. And I spent 3 years at Valley Church in West Des Moines as a high school pastor. And up until recently, I actually just kind of changed careers quite drastically. And now I'm a real estate agent for Remax Concepts here in Central Iowa. So that's a small overview, I suppose.
Now, your mom and dad have really done a lot to honor your brother and turn that event into something constructive, helping other people avoid this. They've been to Washington. They've been on national TV shows. What was it like for you as a freshman and sophomore in high school as they were first sort of dealing with this situation?
Yeah, it was super weird at first, to be honest, you know, for lots of reasons. But, you know, having the local news there, all the major, you know, local news places here in Central Iowa were often at the home. And the reason for that was basically just because when David died, there was so much that we did not know about synthetic drugs and our family, you know, even though we didn't really want to be that, and if we could go back, we would trade it. But we were basically kind of the family that people were talking to, when synthetic drugs came up. So it wasn't, in the beginning, it was really weird. What's even more weird is that it started to become normal. You know, it was just another day like, oh, I guess, you know, and it's horrible because when there was news and people were at the house, that means that somebody had probably passed away. That was usually, you know, so it was not a fun thing, because it was usually, it was prompted by somebody losing their life. So, you know, in the beginning, as you mentioned, you know, kind of the local news outlets. And then it got a little bit more real, I guess, when Good Morning America or other, you know, national news outlets came to the house, or we get flown out to Washington, D.C. a few times. I was kind of just a fly on the wall. My parents did a great job of always including me and being joined on those things and sometimes asking like, hey, you know, do you want to talk to Daniel about this or something? But I knew deep down, you know, my parents were kind of the forerunners in that, but they always kind of graciously, you know, included me in those conversations. But yeah, to answer your question, it was weird. Sometimes I forget how frequent we would, you know, have people over at the house asking about, you know, a synthetic drug related, event. So.
Yeah. Your brother was actually the first one.
Yeah.
To die from these things.
That's right.
And quite frankly, your parents' efforts, probably saved a lot of kids' lives as they push this to the forefront to make parents realize this is an issue. Now here you are, this fly on the wall, and your parents, I know they're a great couple. You know, I've worked with them in the past, and I know how they include you. But how would somebody that doesn't know what's going on measure sort of what you're coping with grief? Is now, I think for a lot of people that are dealing with high school age kids, for parents, that's a tough thing. How do you transition this discussion about grief when something happens like that in the family? And we're seeing so much more of it now with COVID.
Yeah. Yeah. Good point. I'm anxious to see just more and more statistics of what we're going to learn about, you know, high school age and middle school age. Those are kind of the students that I've worked with in my career in ministry. I'm interested to see, you know, what we're going to figure out from this pandemic. And unfortunately, I think it's going to be alarming actually. But yeah, I mean, in my case, I was 15 and a half years old, and it was one of those cases where, you know, a rock was basically dropped on me. I didn't really have a choice. I basically had to grow up, and a huge part of that, and I'm still growing up, I guess, but I mean, a big part of that was really my parents saying, you know, hey, this is what we're going to do. You know, usually, you know, this is stealing probably quotes from all kinds of inspirational speakers, but, you know, a crisis is either going to make you or break you. You really find out who you are. You really find out if, you know, who you think you are is actually who you are when a crisis strikes. And really, unless the crisis strikes, who you think you are is sort of speculation. You don't really know until that's actually tested and purified. And so for us, you know, my parents basically kind of put a stake in the ground and said, this is how we're going to respond as a family. They were very, I guess if parents are listening to kind of touch to one of the things you mentioned, how do parents respond to this? You have to be able to let your teenager grieve. And you have to let them grieve in the way that they need to, not in the way that you do it, not in the way that you wish that they would. You need to allow that like safe space for them to be able to process through whatever's going on. That's really important. That's probably the most important thing.
Well, we'll take a short break, and I really appreciate you sharing that. And we come back from the break, we're going to continue the story and the conversation with Daniel Rosga. You don't want to miss this.
There are everyday actions to help prevent the spread of respiratory diseases. Wash your hands. Avoid close contact with people who are sick. Avoid touching your eyes, nose, and mouth. Stay home when you are sick. Cover your cough or sneeze. Clean and disinfect frequently touched objects with household cleaning spray. For more information, visit cdc.gov/COVID-19. This message brought to you by the National Association of Broadcasters and this station.
Every second, 127 new devices connect to the internet. You can feel it happening, our digital world expanding with every breath. We're entering a whole new era of connectivity, and Mediacom will be ready to power it with one of the nation's first 10G platforms. We'll be bringing you more speed, more capacity, more security, and the power to do more than you ever dreamed possible.
Welcome back to Surviving Bad. We're talking with Daniel Rosga about grieving, healing, and growing up. Dan, so you got this, you're a young kid in high school, your parents put the stake in the ground, and you brought the family together. But at the same time, when you're in those years, when you're growing up as a kid and figuring out where you are in life, you're now carrying a much bigger burden than the average kid. What was that like?
Yeah. Like I mentioned earlier, it really is kind of a foggy memory just because, there's just so many things were going on. I was developmentally changing. I was growing up just like anybody else does in between the ages of 15 and, you know, 18 or whatever. And then I had to deal with losing, my brother. It's something that, you know, I know that you know this about me. Faith has been everything for our family. It really has been. It's been the thing that's kept us together. And so, you know, I remember days going into the school and, you know, I'm going through the halls, walking through classes and I'm having a particularly bad day or I'm really sad or I'm really grieving. And I think the hardest part is walking around and passing by all kinds of teenagers who, I guess in my eyes, don't really understand what I'm carrying. And I still feel that way sometimes, you know, it hasn't gone away. I think the biggest lie in the world, or one of them at least, is that time heals all wounds. I don't think that's really, really true at all. But yeah, I mean, I just remember vividly walking through and not having a great day. My parents were always great. My mom is a very, you know, sweet and honest person, but I even remember her calling into the office and saying, you know, I wasn't feeling very well that day, or kind of calling me in sick basically. And I guess I was sick in a way. You know, it was me grieving. I guess I was like healthy, you know what I'm saying, but she always allowed for me to be able to, you know, hey, if you're not having a good day, call me and we'll figure it out. That's okay. So I remember that.
How about dealing with the kids? Was there some stigma involved in dealing with this, that they put a sort of a chip on your shoulder about some things?
Not at all, really. Honestly, the community of Indianola is amazing. They really rallied around us. They were super supportive of my parents, our church, Indianola Community Church. It's where my parents still attend. They were amazing, rallied around our family, and not just for, you know, the first couple weeks, but even months on, you know, that we've had that community that's supported us. But I can, you know, I guess as I'm talking more, I can remember, you know, sometimes walking through the grocery store, I know my parents have talked about this, and sometimes feeling like, you know, there's a target on our back, like, oh, there's, you know, there's the Rosgas. Did you hear what happened to their son? And, you know, initially, I don't know if you remember this, Peter, but there was a little bit of, you know, conversations, I guess in news, you know, oh my gosh, how did this happen? How did this teenager get this drugs available to him? What's his family doing? That household must be in shambles. And as a 15 and a half year old, 16 year old, to read comments on web pages that were really, really cruel and hurtful and very false things, that really stuck with me. And my parents on more than one occasion had to say, hey, you can't read that stuff, but I'm just kind of a curious person. So I would do and read those things anyway, but never from our community, man. Our community always really supported us. So we're thankful for that.
Now, you did such a great thing as a youth minister. When did that start? When did your involvement in that ministry, what was that somehow a part of this healing process for you as well?
Yeah, I wouldn't say. I think, you know, it was kind of stirring in me before David had died. I basically grew up with an awesome youth pastor, and he had a huge impact on my life and David's life. He was a David's youth pastor too. And I kind of said, and to myself, you know, I want to do something like that for someone someday. If he made this big a difference in my life, I would love to be able to do that for someone else. His name is John Dewey. He's now the lead pastor of the church in Indianola. But yeah, it certainly brought me to a level of vulnerability and connecting with people and being empathetic to people's situations and people's hurt and circumstances. And, you know, I would say that it didn't necessarily, you know, my brother passing away isn't what brought me to ministry, but I think it definitely helped me understand different hurts and experiences from people. And it helped me to connect with them in that way. It was almost like a safeguard, you know, talking with a student or a family or a parent who's experienced something that's hurtful, for me to be able to share my story. It almost feels like we were able to connect in that way. Like, oh, he understands at least a little bit of what I'm going through. So
that's pretty good. And we're going to take another short break, and I'd like to return and talk to you, not just about the role of faith in your life, but this sort of weird dichotomy between faith and maybe social media, because you sort of hinted on that. It was just the world of media that was sometimes really cruel, and faith where you found comfort. So join us after the break. You don't want to miss this. It's going to be interesting. See you after the break.
Today, more than ever, you need fast, reliable internet. At Mediacom, we want you to know you can count on us. Our fiber-powered 100% gigabit technology network was built for the future. We have enormous capacity and power, and 99.99% network reliability. So even though these are uncertain times, we're prepared, and you can be certain we'll keep your world connected.
I may never have met you. We don't go way back. Maybe we wouldn't even be friends if we did. But when you wear a mask, you have my respect. Because your mask doesn't protect you, it protects me. I wear my mask to protect you. Mask up, America.
Welcome back to Surviving Bad. I'm your host, Peter Komandowski, and with Daniel Rozga, we're talking about grieving, healing, and growing up in a world where media drives culture, and finding hope can be an interesting journey. Dan, you talked a little bit about the world of media and how it could be cruel, and the world of faith and how it could be warm. Where are you now? You're an adult. How are you navigating these differences, and how are they relating to where you are in life and grief?
Yeah, it's really interesting, just because I really grew up in an age where social media was developed, and I've been a youth pastor to, this was crazy when I found this out, but some of my students had never grown up in a year that didn't have the smartphone. Every year that they've been alive, the smartphone has been around. Isn't that crazy? So they don't know anything different than this age of media. And I do think it's really interesting. I do think that there's some powerful ways that we can use it. Obviously, this conversation wouldn't be happening. I think the pandemic has shown that there's lots of untapped, positives to media and doing things. But it also can kind of be a scary place. And so, you know, just in working with high schoolers, social media is where they find a lot of their time. I should say, I used to work with high schoolers as a pastor, and I've spoken with countless parents who've said, now, how can I get my kid off their phone? They're always on their phone. They always need to be on their phone. And I get that. They don't know a whole lot different, but yeah, social media is just an interesting place. And when you're young, and when you are, I'll just speak for myself and going what I went through with my brother, you have to be careful with what you're reading online. It's really safe for someone to just type things behind a keyboard and not be able to have a real conversation with you. Maybe they would speak a little bit more. You know, they maybe aren't quite as candid because it's safe. Anybody can type anything behind a screen. But you know, for me, in growing up with social media, it was something that I had to really separate from my faith. I think a lot of people are on social media and they're posting things and they're waiting for a response. They're waiting to be affirmed with what they've just posted, whether it's a picture, they want it to get shares, they want it to get likes. I experienced that as a real estate agent. I'll post something and I'll say, man, I really hope that, you know, this finds people's eyes. I really hope that, you know, people can see that this happened. It doesn't even have to be a bad thing. But what's scary is posting things on social media, awaiting to be affirmed, versus already knowing that you're affirmed and you're confident in who you are. And, you know, a response from other people or a like or whatever is not necessary for you to know who you are. You already know who you are. But we're growing up in an age, I think, where a lot of people are finding who they are by the response that they get online, which is twofold. It can be negative. It can be twofold. Some people can think that they're something that they're not in a positive sense. You know, they can think they're all that because they're getting all these, you know, they're getting shares, they're getting likes, they're getting follows. Or on the flip side, somebody could be, you know, maybe not getting quite as much traction to their page, and they could take that personally. I know that sounds foreign, maybe to some parents, but truly, trust me, that's how a lot of middle school and high school age students, even college students, think. They really find a lot of their value from the response that they get through social media.
Now, when you were, you did enter into an era. You grew up in an era of social media, but you didn't know the world beforehand. When you're hurting, when you're grieving, it sounds like media can really be a dangerous place because that human connection isn't there. And if that's true and your experiences bear that out, how do we warn kids that never saw the world without it to be careful of that?
Yeah, that's a great question. I think a lot of it starts early in the way that you parent your kids, establish boundaries from the beginning of, hey, you know, this is the amount of time that we spend on our phone, and that's normal. I think the later you wait, as your child grows up, the harder it is to establish those boundaries. The more you're coined as the parent who's mean or, you know, hates technology or something like that. So I think establishing boundaries early is a really important thing to kind of set the precedent. You know, then they grow up and they don't really know, I guess, anything different. I guess that would be the most practical thing that I would do.
Now, in your mid 20s now, do you find yourself setting boundaries?
Oh gosh, no. I mean, and that's the funny thing that I've realized, especially, you know, 26, I'm really close with my parents. We very much have a friend relationship now. The funny thing is realizing that, you know, they do some of the same things that I was told I couldn't do as a kid growing up, you know, as a person who's kind of got his foot in both camps of working with students and also growing into adulthood, if you're a parent listening, I mean, sometimes we got to lighten up a little bit. And we got to realize, or I guess I'll say this, we have to realize that if our kids don't see us as adults doing what we're asking them to do, then, you know, it's tough to expect them to be able to follow through. The answer of, you know, because I said so, just isn't really working anymore. So,
well, on that note, we're going to take a break. And after break, I'm going to invite Daniel to share some final comments and some good advice. You don't want to miss this.
I don't know how we would have survived without Mediacom. We have five kids, my wife and I. And we have Mediacom for all of our internet and all of our cable services. So I'm stuck in my house, but at the same time, I'm connected to people all over the world, and it's been fantastic.
Thanks to Mediacom, I've had reliable internet to continue to work business as usual, so that I can continue to provide for myself and my family.
Right now, we all feel like the world is in a standstill. The internet has played a huge role in allowing us to stay connected to our jobs and the kids schooling online and finding fun and creative ways to stay connected with the ones that we love. We couldn't do it without Mediacom.
Right now, millions of people and billions of devices are connected to the internet. Homes, businesses, hospitals, schools. The security and reliability of these connections are more important than ever. That's why at Mediacom, we've built a network to protect them. A network that sees threats, fixes problems before they occur, and keeps you going with 99.99% network reliability.
Welcome back. Today on Surviving Bad, we're taking a moment to talk about grief and healing for a young man in a world that seems to be spiraling out of control. Let's hear what advice Daniel has to share that may help you. Daniel, you've had a heck of a journey, and you've survived something we hope most people don't have to. But yet every day people face challenges where the things and lessons you've learned have some relevance. What would you share with our listeners?
Yeah, well, thanks so much for having me on, Peter. You guys are awesome. I love what you're doing. Maybe a couple pieces of advice that have at least helped me. One, I think, would be just in general, normalizing conversations around mental health, I think, are huge. We've mentioned even some of these things that are happening during the pandemic. I just think there's a bit of a stigma around mental health. You know, there's something wrong with them, or, oh my gosh, they must, they're crazy or something. And you know, it's not helping somebody who's hurting, because then they realize, oh great, now I'm hurting and I'm crazy. It hurts. And so I really try to make that a normal thing. I go to therapy. I make that very plain, and I love sharing that. It's changed my entire life. So I would say that, normalizing conversations around mental health. I would say parents trying to do your best to create a space where your kids are able to talk to you about things. You know, I remember growing up not saying things to my parents because I was scared I would get in trouble, or I was just scared about how they would respond. And parents, sometimes we gotta pick our battles of what we're gonna decide to kind of press on. You know, and sometimes you might have to be a little lenient on what you know, you're talking with your kid about so that you can open up the door to have conversations with them. Cause I think a lot of these, you know, bringing it back to even synthetic drugs, for example, you know, teenagers likely probably don't have a relationship where they're able to process through that with their parents. Like, hey dad, somebody brought this to the party. And I'm not really sure what I should do with it. They don't talk to their parents cause they're like, oh man, I wasn't supposed to go to the party, or, oh man, they're not going to let me hang out with that friend because they brought that, you know, just as an example. But, you know, I'm not saying lighten up on your rules or anything, but I'm just saying, try to be strategic in how you can, you know, try to open up conversations where your kid would want to talk to you, I guess, about those things. And I guess the last thing I would just share. Oh, you go.
Can you grief was forced upon your family, but yeah. We're living in a world today where we have people aging, we have people dying from COVID. There's more grief in the world, and we're not having less suicides. We're not having less overdoses. So it's just piling up on it. From your experience, can a parent prepare their children for grief?
That's a really great question. It's completely, to be honest with you, Peter, I guess I would say no. Completely prepare. That's not to say there's not things that you can do to kind of lessen it. But if I was to tell you, man, I could have completely prepared for the fact that my brother died when he was 18, when I was 15, that's crazy. No, I couldn't have completely prepared, but I did have those relationships in place for when grief happened. I knew where to go. And I think that's the main point. For me, it was my faith. It was my church. It was my youth group. It was my friends. It was my parents. And so was I able to fully, you know, prepare for it? No, because I still grieve. I still get sad. I still cry. I still am grieving the loss of my brother, probably much, much more than the people who are close to me even realize. But what I would say is I did have established rhythms in place to where I knew where to go when grief struck. And I would have never thought that it was like, oh, I'm preparing for my brother to die. I would have never thought that. But I'm sure glad that I was investing in those things. I'm sure glad that my parents made it a priority to communicate with each other, to be friends, to laugh, to go to church. I'm glad that they established those things, because if I didn't, I don't know where I would be.
Well, I thank you so very much, Daniel, for sharing your story and this advice. And we thank you all for joining us today. Check out our website, healthyiowa.org, for more information. And keep your eye on Mediacom MC22 for our next episode of Surviving Bad, where we explore Iowa stories of survival, hope, and inspiration. On Mediacom MC22, your local programming leader.